morning, everybody. Good morning on this Memorial Day Sunday. It is good to be together. Amen. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord. I'm so grateful that the good Lord has led us to be together on a day like this, to worship Him and to be in fellowship with one another. Our hope and our prayers that through this time together, that the good Lord would cause the cups of our hearts to be overflowing with His love, with His mercy, and with His grace. Amen? Amen? Amen. Well, I do have some important tidbits to share with you. We are still looking for some greeters. If you're interested in being a friendly face to greet our regulars and our guests, then we are looking for you. The stained glass window campaign is underway. Is Trillia in the house? I don't believe she is. We will have, and maybe already have, some handouts that will kind of encapsulate that campaign and give you an idea of what the work that is needed to be done is. And even we'll give you an update as to where we're at with the raising of the funds. But I know we have over 20,000 has been pledged, and not all of that has come in yet, but it is coming. And so we thank you for your generosity in making this happen. But we're still about 20 grand short of our goal. So that is where we're at. We're almost to that halfway point, and may actually even be at that halfway point once all the donations have been counted. So thank you, thank you, thank you. You as a congregation are just so incredibly generous, and it is amazing to see that generosity just flow and to make things happen. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Also, the women's banquet.
Yes, women's dinner this Saturday in the theater. So, we have 13 tables. Ladies are hosting.
In area.
Unmute the mic.
Mic one.
That's okay.
The sheer honesty.
Hey, am I on? Can you hear me now? Okay. Anyway, I'm going to talk.
There it is.
There it is. So this Saturday is the women's dinner. First one we've had in seven years. I'm so excited. We have 13 tables that ladies are hosting. About 8 of them are totally full, but we still have 10 to 15 spots for ladies to just come. So if you can come, we'd love for you to come. So please see me at the table so we can get you assigned to sit with one of the tables that's being hosted. So you don't have to do anything except show up. Some of the ladies are paying for their table, so you might get a sign up at a table that's already been paid for. So if not, it's only $10. You'll get your $10 worth, ladies. Please be here about 5:45 so you have time to look around at all the beautiful tables before we start serving at 6 o'clock. Men, I know several of you have told me you will come and serve, and we are so grateful. The men do a wonderful job. If you are coming to serve, check in with me at the table so I can mark you off and get you assigned to take care of a certain lady's table. And if you are a gentleman who's coming and have not gotten a blue sheet, please do. It tells you where to be, when to be, and what to wear. So a lot of people need to see me at the table. Yeah, we have men who have a lot of ideas about what they want to wear, but we're all going to look nice for you ladies that night.
Let me ask a question about that attire. Is black t-shirts on the menu?
We might make an exception for one person.
I was getting ready to have some anxiety. I was like, oh. No, thank you, Jill, and it's going to be wonderful. The last time we had this, it was absolutely fantastic. I know the food is going to be great. It is just an incredible evening. If you've not signed up, please sign up. You will be blessed to be a part of this. And men, let me echo, make sure we get that blue sheet. And Rob, you listening? Yeah, all right, blue sheet. And with that, let us stand for this morning's call to worship, Majesty.
Sing it out. Here we go.
Majesty. Worship His Majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. majesty. Shake a few hands.
Pray together. Heavenly Father, we just come before you here this day, this Memorial Day, this day where we honor or remember the sacrifice of brave men and women. Today we pray that you would cause the hearts of our lives to swell with gratitude for those that served, that protected, that gave of their lives, that we could gather here freely. We pray that God, that we would not take for granted with the way that we live our lives, that we would not take for granted the sacrifice of all those men and women. Father, today we pray that through this time of worship, that we would just fix our eyes upon you, Jesus, who too sacrificed your life for us. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
Let's take our hymn books to hymn number 696, America the Beautiful. Hymn number 696. We'll sing all three stanzas.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesties above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Oh, beautiful, for heroes proved in liberating strife, who more than self their country loved, and mercy more than life. America, America, may God thy gold refine, till all success be nobleness and end. control thy liberty in law.
Amen. Very good singing. And now would you please join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Celebrate Memorial Day for so we can remember those who have fought for this country and have died. Because freedom is not free. They have fought so we could worship the way we want to worship, that we can do what we want to do, not what everybody else is telling us how we should worship. And there's many, many that came home. They didn't lose their lives, but they came home. But the effects of the wars and that has stayed with them for years and years and years. And we need to remember those too, because they may not have given up their life per se, but they gave up something. They gave up their time. They gave up their will. They gave it for us, sort of like, not quite, but sort of like what Jesus did for us, right? That he died for us. Now, I know both of my sons have served in the armed forces, and my husband did too, and my brother-in-laws, and a lot of my friends. And we have a lot of people in here that have served. Will they stand, please? If you have served in the military, any form? It gives me goosebumps. It really does. It gives me goosebumps. We need to go up. When we see a soldier, do you see soldiers ever so often out on the street? No? Well, ever so often you will, and you'll see one or a person that has a hat on that says Vietnam veteran or Korea veteran or something on their head, on their hat, go up, and you'll be surprised if you see a soldier or something, go up and just say, thank you. That's all you have to say, is thank you. And it makes them feel very good. It makes me feel good because I know I'm safe. So this week or tomorrow while we're doing this, think about the soldiers that are protecting us now. And there's several. There's a whole bunch of them. So what are you going to do for Memorial Day? Are you going to have a picnic or a cookout or shoot off fireworks like somebody was doing around 11 o'clock last night? Was it you?
Nope.
Oh, okay.
Nope.
Okay, good.
It's July 4th. Yep.
But let us remember the people that have given their lives for our country. For our country isn't perfect, but it's the best one here. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for these children. We love them so very dearly. And we thank you for the men and women that have served our country. Many have given their lives, many just a portion of it, but it leaves a mark on them that they will never forget. Watch over each and every child, and we are all your children. Keep us safe, watch over us, and bring us all back here, for we love these kids very much, and they are our future. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thanks, kids.
Good luck, Julie.
Thank you.
Oh. Love it. Love it, love it, love it. Oh, this morning, do we have some joys, some good news that we'd like to share? Some good news, some joys. Yes?
It's Roxanna's 29th birthday.
Happy birthday, Rox. Yeah. Yes, indeed. Any other joys? Some other good news? Love hearing good news. Yes, there in the middle.
Yeah, I just want to say there was an error when we put out when they could bring the small items to the rummage sale.
Oh.
Oh,
we have a joy to share with you. Those small items can come a whole month earlier on June the 1st. Indeed. You know, I do have another joy I want to share. And we're putting this date a little bit far off just because there's a lot going on here in the next 6 weeks or so. But there's a number of folks that are wanting to join our congregation. And we're going to, in the month of July, have a celebration of that and bring in those members. So you'll be hearing more and more about that as we approach that. But it is awesome to see the church grow and for more people to want to join and to be a part of this congregation, to serve the Lord together, to be in fellowship together. So I just, you know, praise God for that. It's awesome. And if you're interested in joining, whom just made that joyful praise of announcement, see Debbie after church, and she has some paperwork for you that we would ask you to fill out. Any other joys? All right. Any prayer concerns? Oh,
Berta. The Beavers finally won a game.
Say what?
Beavers.
The Beavers finally won a game. Heaters.
Fever.
They did. Caitlin Clark and the Fevers. Now I'm following you. I saw the headline. I was like, did she say Beaver? I was like, I don't know what team that is, but I'm just going to go with it, you know? Oh, that's funny. Percussors, yeah. Adam and Sarah closed on a house. They'll be moving next week. Definitely prayers for them and prayers for anyone else that's in a time of transition. Transitions can be intense, so definitely. Yes?
I'm halfway through my pregnancy.
halfway through your pregnancy. Yes. Congratulations. Really. It is such a fun time. Yeah. And then they become teenagers. So, yeah. But that's another topic for, yeah.
Brother.
Definitely prayers for your brother that they had to stop the chemo due to some complications, and just pray that God would be with him and you and the rest of the family. Absolutely. Couple more. Yeah.
Just want to lift up my mom, Marilyn Hart. She had a fall about a week and a half ago. She's now in a wheelchair. They are starting some small doses of morphine just to help the pain. So just praying God's will on her life and her timing, that she'll either get stronger. I'm going to go see her later today. Today's my birthday, so I'll share that with my mother. But just that we could lift her up in prayer, I appreciate that.
Absolutely. Marilyn Hart, who's been a part of this church, part of the choir, part of almost everything that's happened in this church for decades. And I had a fall, and so definitely want to pray for strength or pray for what God wills. But definitely prayers for you all, and prayers for that visit today too as well. Definitely. Yes?
For my friend Mel.
Mel, definitely. Well, today being Memorial Day, we do have a video we wanted to share to have a way of reflecting and really celebrating those that have served. So check this out. Let's pray together. Father, today we pray for those families that do have an empty seat around the table. And we pray that today that you would wrap your loving arms around those spouses, those children, those parents, those grandparents, where today is a day that pride would swell in their hearts for the service that was given. But today being the day that grief, that the pains of grief would also be mingled in. And we pray that God, that you would bring your healing to the lives of those families. the lives of those soldiers that lost friends, that lost brothers, that lost sisters. We just pray that you would impart your grace deep within. Father, today for us as a country, we especially pray. We pray that we as Americans would live lives worthy of their sacrifice, that we would live lives where we love others more than self, where we would live lives that we in our day-to-day lives too sacrifice for others. We pray that God, that today, that the cross will be planted again anew within our minds and within our hearts, that we would look to the great sacrifice of your Son that enables each and every one of us here today to be forgiven of every last sin. And today, Father, we pray that that forgiveness would flow not just into our hearts that are here in this sanctuary, but that forgiveness, that healing, would flow into the hearts of all across this land. Father, we pray that we wouldn't fixate upon just what is broken in this land, but God, that if we do see something broken, that we would have the courage to find a way to fix it. But we pray that, God, that we would remember the good things, that we would remember to celebrate what is good about this country. And we pray that, God, that in that celebration yet again, that gratitude would swell within our hearts for those men and women that enable us to be here and to do so. I invite you, church, now to pray with me the prayer that our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. I'm finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down Refreshing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak.
Thank you, Tim. Yes. Beautiful song.
And very well done. Very well done. Thank you, Tim. You are truly are a blessing. You know, I want to encourage you, church. Earlier we had folks that served in the military to stand and encourage you after the service to look those folks out and just thank them. Just thank them. A simple word of gratitude goes a long, long, long way. Well, today we're going to be looking at the message that's around light. It's going to be coming from Isaiah chapter 58 and verses 8 through 11. And then, as there always is, there'll be a plethora of other scripture that we'll chew into, dive into, to kind of explore these ideas. But water, air, food, shelter, clothing, all necessities, things that are needed to live life. But universally, there's another need, necessity, that is required for us as people and all other living things on earth, be it animals or plants, that we require to live this thing called life: light. If the sun were to mysteriously vanish from the sky, it would take about 8 minutes for us to notice. It takes 8 minutes for the light to come from the sun to the earth, so we'd have about 8 minutes of normal life, but then things would start to change. Yes, indeed. Without the light of the sun, photosynthesis would stop and plants would quit creating oxygen, and we'll just say bad things would begin to happen. Within a few days, however, says one Ashley Hammer, writing for Discovery, the temperature would begin to drop, and any humans left on the planet's surface would, well, die soon after. Within 2 months, the ocean's surface would freeze over, but it would take another 1,000 years for our seas to freeze solid. By then, however, the atmosphere would collapse and radiation would seep in, and the Earth would be an inhospitable wasteland drifting aimlessly through space. Ashley concludes with a rather hopeful word, though. She says, "Lucky for us, the sun is showing no signs of disappearing soon." Whew, that's good. But that's what happens when the light, is snubbed out of the earth and our lives as part of the created order. Bad things happen when there's no light. But what happens when light, now the sun, is snubbed out from our day-to-day lives? It's been proven that during the winter months, when the sky is clouded over and people are indoors more than not, that people's happiness dips. Heard of seasonal depression, and folks point to the lack of good old vitamin D. Or take Exhibit A. Exhibit A. This is what happens whenever you have light and petunias and grass. It's lush, it's pretty. Sarah and I actually put this together. We didn't buy it like this. We actually put this together, didn't we, honey? Yeah, Exhibit A. This is what happens when light is poured out upon a plant. Now, what would happen if I placed this beautiful hanging basket that is actually rather heavy? Like doing a workout here. Yeah. Now, what would happen if I placed this beautiful hanging basket in a cellar, in the cellar of the parsonage, for the entire summer? What would happen to this? Anybody? What would happen? Who would die? In the cellar, there's no daylight at all. There's no sun at all. Sure, it'd be okay for a day or two. maybe in a few days. But over time, without precious sunlight, this basket, this beautiful hanging basket, would shrivel and wither. And eventually, too, well, its life would be snubbed out. Or say, you're a 10-year-old boy, and you go visit your grandpa and grandmother's new home that they'd bought in Ligoti. For a time for them to move in, they rented said home out to the then superintendent of Ligoti Schools and his family. Said superintendent happened to have kids that, well, wanted to play hide and seek mixed with tag at said house and happened to be at night. And one of said kids finds you in your hiding spot, and you decide to dash from that hiding spot and bolt out the front door and run full steam away in the dark from your tagger. All seemed well initially. Process of fleeing from said tagger, only for you to turn a dark corner in the backyard, and then suddenly you see the sky, and you hit the ground with a very hard thud. And then you begin to see stars, but not the kind of stars that are in the sky, but the kind of stars that are in your vision. And then after said stars fade, you see a clothesline overhead, swaying in the night sky. If that whole thing had happened in daylight, I would have seen the clothesline posts. And I would have known not to run full steam ahead into the clothesline. And I would have saved myself a really nasty scar that, or a scab that went from all the way across my face. Light is necessary for life. It's necessary to keep beautiful garden plants and petunias and zebra grasses and sunflowers alive. Light, the sun, is what keeps the world spinning, what allows us to navigate this thing called life. Well, just as the created order, people to the earth itself, relies upon the sun for light and life, so we as people rely upon Christ, the sun, S-O-N, for light and life as well. See, there's being alive via breathing, and then there's being alive. And you may have heard it said of people that, well, they were dead long before they took their last breath, implying that people can be physically alive, walking, talking, working, but be completely dead on the inside. Withered up as a basket of petunias in a cellar. Well, Christ is what brings life to these mortal bodies. Christ and His grace and His love is what causes us as people to, like plants out in sunshine, to thrive, to grow, to be alive, to flourish again. Flourish personally, emotionally, mentally, like this here hanging basket. See if I can put it up here. Oh, there we go. Let's let those beautiful petunias glow. But now, what's exhilarating to me is that Christ has very much called us, you, me, to be. This is an old kid's song, sunbeams in this world. To be people whom cast not shadows and darkness upon others, but people who shine the light and love of Christ upon other people in the world. Imparting to the people, to our family, to our friends, to our neighbors, little rays of happiness Rays of joy, rays of hope, rays of encouragement, rays of life from him to help cause them to flourish like that hanging basket. He's called us to be his light in this world. Which brings us to our passage, Isaiah chapter 58, verses 8 through 11. May stand for this reading, portion of the reading of God's word. I loved it. I saw a bunch of people on the ready, and I stopped just for a second. Oh, here we go. Then shall your light break forth like dawn, and your healing shall spring up speedily. Your righteousness shall go before you, and the glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry, and he will say, "Here I am." If you take away the yoke from your midst, the pointing of the finger and the speaking of wickedness. If you pour out yourself for the hungry and satisfy the desire of the afflicted, then shall your light rise in the darkness and your gloom be as the noonday. And the Lord will guide you then continually and satisfy your desire in scorched places and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters do not fail. Let's pray together. Lord, in this continued time of preaching and teaching, we just ask that you, Holy Spirit, whom inspired the original writing of this word from Isaiah, that you would inspire here today the preaching and hearing of your word. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. So this passage, it comes close to the end of the book of Isaiah. It is a passage that in the broader context was dealing with people that were desiring, longing for God to move in their lives, longing for God to pour out blessings in their lives, to do good by them. Yet all the way, they spent their days exploiting their fellow brother or sister, fellow neighbor or friend. With their lips, they said, they served God. With their worshipful actions, they fasted and pleaded with God to move. But then in their day-to-day dealings with others, you would not have been able to tell that they were any different than the rest of the people of the land. They said with their mouths, "I am a Jew." They said that with their lips, but they said, "I am not a Jew," with their actions and their dealings with others. One moment they were worshiping God through song and prayer, and the next biting and devouring others with their words and with their actions. Instead of exploiting others, God called for the people to loose the bonds of wickedness, meaning that they should rather strive to bring relief to the lives of those around them, to make life more joyful and less burdensome to live, to fight for justice instead of being a people of injustice, to be a people who would seek to free others from entrapments and bad situations rather than being the wicked that were doing the entrapping and then praying that God would somehow bless them. Instead of biting and devouring others, God called the people to build each other up, to cause the people around them to soar to new heights rather than clip their wings with their words and or actions. Instead of living hypocritically by declaring one's faith with their mouths, by denying the very essence of faith and dealing with others, God called the people to be authentic in what they believed and authentic in how they lived out those very beliefs. Then, when they as a people lived out good old common sense, when they as a people treated others like they wanted to be treated, then when they as people sought to impart life and to build other people up and not tear them down, then the light of God would spill forth from them as a nation and would bring what was needed to answer their prayers. God's justice then would be experienced all around. It's a beautiful passage and a beautiful idea of justice. All of which had me thinking of a quote by the founder of Methodism, good old John Wesley. He called Methodists to do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as you ever can. Wesley believed then the light of the love of God would pour forth in such a way that the people in his life and in the Methodists' lives would in droves come to know Jesus. For that light would lead them to the path to Christ, which in turn would cause the transformation of the world. What if this were the commitment of our lives? What would our relationships look like? What would the communities that we're a part look like if we sought to do all the good we could possibly do in other people's lives? Such a simple yet beautiful idea. Now, I've learned that there are people in this world who care really only about themselves, whose motivation for whatever they do is self. They care for what they want, what they think, period. That is to say, there are people in this world who do the opposite of what Wesley and what God said through Isaiah. Complete opposite of what we've been talking about. Instead of allowing the light of God to spill forth from their lives through good works in the world and encouraging words, they cause the shadow that already darkens the world to darken even more by spilling even more darkness from their hearts through selfish acts and self-centered deeds. These folks, to Jesus' call to be sunbeams, are what I'd like to call Eeyore beams. I made that up myself. These people have very little room in their lives for others. They, even though they may never admit it, see people as a means to an end, rather than people made in the image and likeness of God, whom should be cherished, and whom, on this Memorial Sunday, whom are worth dying for. And they, instead of give, take. They, instead of encourage, discourage. Or they, instead of uplift, deflate. They, instead of love, hate. While Eeyore beam may be harsh, I probably should get a patent on that. Because we all love Eeyore. Who doesn't love Eeyore? But that cloud that seemingly surrounds old Eeyore in the 100-acre woods is something that really can occur in our lives as people as well. Or it seems to our disposition or their disposition and their dealings with others or mood, there's just a cloud about them that dampens the mood and the vibe of any and all that they encounter. But the good news is this: it doesn't have to be so. Just as rays of sunshine pierce cloudy skies, Christ's light can pierce the cloud that's been hovering, and by way of the wind of his spirit, can cause those clouds to dissipate entirely. So where does this cloud, or where does this piercing Eeyore beam come? From where within us as people can we store darkness or light? According to Jesus, it happens to be the heart. This is one of those passages I'm getting ready to share that's become a core, like a pillar in the realm of my beliefs. And I share it often in varying contexts. But Jesus in Matthew chapter 15, he said this: "But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the," say it with me, "heart." And Jesus says that it is this that defiles a person. He says, for out of the heart comes evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, slander. And Jesus again says, and these are what truly defiles a person. Jesus' response here was to questions about Old Testament purity laws. That's what he was responding to with that bit of word. He offended some Pharisees. Yes. When he did not make his disciples wash their hands before partaking of a meal. More than germs in Jesus' day, this act was an act of purity, preparing oneself in accordance with the law, the Old Testament law, for the partaking of food. And Jesus' disciples were caught red-handed to not have washed their hands before they ate, and offended a group of Pharisees. To which Jesus said this. See, just as then, so are people today very concerned with outward appearances, about how we are perceived, about what people think about us, about our clothing, our homes, your vehicles, you name it. What Jesus was here saying was all of these things could be externally in order, and yet our hearts could still be desperately sick. So sick that we pour through our words and our deeds and our dealings with others shadowy gray skies instead of beautiful sunny sunlight, sunny skies. Where we just have a way of turning folks' smiles upside down into frowns. The Pharisees, they checked all the external boxes. Yet they were underneath it all, not all of them, but a good chunk, cruel, judgmental, and overly critical. They were the enforcers of the law, and they kept a judgmental eye upon all their constituents. Yet behind all their gold and all their flashiness, behind all the external boxes they checked, their hearts were desperately, like us all before the touch of Christ, desperately sick. And were indeed being Eeyore beams instead of sunbeams. They were not as a group causing the people around them, the people that they were in charge of overseeing, they weren't causing people to thrive. They were not causing people's lives to flourish like that hanging basket. They were rather causing the lives of the people around them to be more akin to this almost bundle of death. Anybody ever had a houseplant go like this? This was the effect of the Pharisees in the lives of those people in the first century. It's quite the difference, isn't it? And put that right there in your center table. Somebody could use that for your women's table. No? You don't think? And well, Jesus, he called them out on it. He called them out on it. They were so worried about external appearances and playing the part that they missed what was vastly more important, the people, and matters of love and justice. You know, something that Sarah and I have been discussing at length for months now is how many people in the world today are living their lives, and ourselves at times included, with wounded hearts, with hearts where others have inflicted, due to words or actions, real harm and real pain. For some, these wounds, they can go all the way back to their childhood. Are they today, because they've not found healing for things said or done, still carry with them open, gaping wounds that could be literally decades old? There's healing, hear me. There's healing to be found for those wounds. Healing through conversation, healing through prayer, healing through counseling, healing for such wounds. But the only way those wounds will ever get better is if we as people make the willful decision to give our wounded hearts and the sad state they may be in to Christ. He then will lead us on a journey of healing, a journey of wholeness, which even while on said journey, before all the healing takes place, there will be not just clouds about you, but light, sunshine. If one doesn't, though, and just allows those wounds to fester, and carries those wounds about, carries that offense about, wounds from childhood about, wounds from previous relations about, wounds from current relations about. Well, this, my friends, is a breeding ground for us to become, here it is again, Eeyore beams. I'm proud of that. So creative. Instead of sunbeams. For pain and wounds and trauma and offense, it's fertile soil for darkness to cultivate deep within, which in time will cause gray clouds to hover. And if they are allowed to persist, hover even more. Jesus put this all another way when he taught. This is Luke 6. He said, "For no good tree bears bad fruit, nor again does a bad tree bear good fruit. Says a good person out of the good treasure of his heart produces good. And the evil person out of his evil treasure produces evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, his mouth speaks." What is treasured within is what will mark your life with light or darkness. When a heart has been touched by God, is being healed by God, is being renewed by God, that heart will produce a garden crop of gargantuan proportions. Maybe a little bit like my tomato patch. But when a heart is fixed upon harboring darkness, harboring pain, harboring offense, then out of that heart will come an abundance of dandelions and thistles. See, we can proclaim like the Jews did from Isaiah, "I am a Christian," but the deeds and the aura and the vibe of our life, that can say otherwise. A true mark of a follower of Christ, and some won't like this, but hey, isn't external righteous perfection, but rather is someone who is being transformed from the inside out by him. Where the atmosphere of our lives is daily churning less and less cloudy. Where by the day, or slowly and at times more quickly, becoming more and more and more like him. Where we become some much needed light to cause the lives of the people around us to thrive rather than wither and die. So in closing, I thought I'd leave you with a bright, shining example of what we've been talking about. Of someone being a sunbeam for Jesus. It's really kind of funny that it's an example of sunbeam, and well, you'll see why. So last week, I preached a message around leaven. And we talked a good deal about bread. Well, after the service, Wayne, could you raise your hand at me here? Wayne here, he came up to me. And he told me that Jeff, who happens to be sitting next to Wayne right now, has perfected his recipe for sourdough bread. I then went and I sought Jeff out because I love sourdough bread. And I found Jeff. He was about to leave, but I found him. And I said, "Jeff, I'm officially placing an order for a loaf of sourdough bread." Thought that would be the end of it. Fast forward to Thursday, and there was a ring from the front door. My son Luke always gets excited when someone comes over, and he, with pipes like his father's, yelled at the top of his lungs, "Dad! Dad, someone's at the front door. Who needs Alexa to notify you when you got a Luke around? But I got off track. I wasn't, shockingly, expecting any Amazon packages or deliveries that day. So my curiosity was piqued. Who's at my front door? Well, standing at my front door was Jeff. In hand was a fresh loaf of sourdough bread. He dropped that off, and man, he had a big old smile on my face. And guess what? I turned around, and I had a big old smile on my cheesy face, too. Now, Jeff didn't know this, but I was not having a good day that day. I was wrestling with some heavy emotions. Life can do that, can't it? And that offer of bread was an offer of light. And it cut through my gloom. It cut through my heaviness like a knife through warm butter. Because that's what happened with that bread. But that's all it takes. We make it so difficult. That's all it takes to be a sunbeam. To simply think about someone else. And do as Christ would. Offer some kindness. Offer some grace. Offer a gift. A smile. Jeff was being a sunbeam that day. Thank you, Jeff. And why I thought it was funny that the example of sunbeam had bread is because my kids eat sunbeam bread all the time. It's a yellow loaf, you know. Used to have praying hands on it. They ain't praying no more, though, I noticed. Oh, and by the way, that sourdough bread was delicious. Emphasis on was.
Let's take our hymn books and turn to hymn number 467, our closing hymn, Trust and Obey. We're going to sing two verses, the first and the third, and let's stand as we sing. Trust and Obey, first and third. When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey.
May we be sunbeams and not, say it with me, Eeyore beams. Amen.
Let's do a closing, honey. Let's Let's do Because He Lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Amen. Here we go.
Because He lives, I can face tomorrow.
Jim Turney.
To God be the glory as we grow with Him.
To God be the glory as we grow with Him. Folks, have a safe, happy Memorial Day. We'll see you all next time. And remember, thank somebody that served. Thank them.